Thank you.
Okay. Hi, everyone. So I'm James. I'm actually based in the Valley. I'm back in Singapore for Chinese New Year. So it just happens that it's a coincidence that this Hackware session is like at the right time, right? So finally, I can be here, give a short presentation about something that I've been working on for about the past like half a year or so. Okay, so the topic of it is basically wireless power delivery for indoor low power devices. Now, later on, you'll probably understand why it is only for low power devices indoors. Okay, so the backstory. How many of you here actually have home automation? Yeah, raise your hands. Okay, so you have like many sensors placed around the house, doors, windows, motion sensors. Do they all use batteries? Well, generally, if you set up a home automation when you renovate your house, right, most of your things will be wired in, so that's fine. But for, let's say you are just moving in, you're renting a place, and you have home automation, you install these devices which are battery operated. Right? So in a typical home in the States, right, I have a smoke detectors, carbon monoxide detectors, all these kinds of doors and sensors, right? And if you look at other battery-operated things, you have Xbox, PlayStation 4, wireless keyboard, mouse, some of you use some door camera, right? Aircon, TV remote, Fire TV, Apple TV, all kinds of set-top boxes just because we get them there. Yeah, so we have all these kinds of things over there, and we realize that, one of the key pain points is that they use all kinds of different types of batteries. And I don't stock batteries at home. When I eat them, I go to Amazon, I press a button, and it arrives the next day, right? So you have AA batteries, AAA batteries, 9-volt cells, used in smoke detectors. I don't know, the state just loves to use 9-volt cells. Weird-looking CR2 or 123A batteries, which are these little cells that go into the door or window sensor. It's not common, and of course, you've got your pretty common CR2, 32 in some little remotes. Right, so this is an approximate rundown of their capacity. And typically these cells, or rather your devices, have a typical runtime of maybe half a year, 1 year, or in some faulty Amazon Fire TV remote controls, it's like 1 month. So in a typical tech at your home, if I count all my battery operated devices, I actually have more than 30 of them. Right, so when I first started off setting up my home automation system, I was really happy. It's like, oh, it's so cool. I install a sensor here, a sensor there, on the windows, doors. And a little bit like near reaching the 1 year mark, the battery started to fail. Right, so on my home automation panel, I start seeing them going disappearing one by one, right? And I had to go and replace the battery. So, okay, fine. I bought a couple of batteries. I replaced one of them. Two of them. When you went down to like the 22nd, 23rd device, you are really tired. And it is not just one day, it's over a period of time because batteries don't run out of power at the same time, right? It's just like across the entire time. And it just keeps distracting you. Your smoke alarm, when you run out of power, it wakes you up in the middle of the night beeping, right? How pleasant is that? And typically, if you don't remember where your devices are, especially the sensors on doors and windows, they are like, kind of like obscure places. You will not know it is there, or you don't remember where it is, you don't know what kind of battery it uses. So you open and check, you realize that you don't have it in stock, you order it, you come back a day later. So it's just really tedious. Or if I add to my to-do list, my whole list will fill of things to do, like buy detergent, replace batteries, these kind of stuff. So what if I told you that there's no longer need to replace batteries anymore, or I hope, right? So one of the things I thought was, what if I could have a beacon in the ceiling, right, which that can charge all the devices in my room without me caring where it is. Of course, there's some exceptions. If I, put it in a LED box or in a Faraday cage, it wouldn't charge. But you'll see why later. Okay, so with that in mind, right, there's actually a couple of existing solutions. If any of you been to CES early this year, January? So at CES, there are a couple of wireless powering startups, right? There's Energius, Wytricity. Ubeam has been around for a couple of years, but seriously, I mean, if you just Google about it, you, any, like, if you're a physics major or something, you'll know why it's kind of silly. But Yeah, so in general, the key idea is that many of these wireless energy technologies, right, they have a transmitter, they beam radio frequency, radio energy, right, across the distance. It could be centimeters, it could be feet. So with that in mind, right, you may wonder, like, is this really dangerous? Or, you know, what are the implications of, like, flying the room with radio energy, right? One of the things to note is that many of these devices, they operate within a certain power limit. So over here, right, we see that there's a typical power limit, the one I highlighted there, primarily because I'm using that frequency, it's about 1 watt, right? And just keep in mind that we must have a, we must conform to these kinds of limitations, right? And many of these companies, they also have to be restricted to these kinds of limitations. Yeah, so basically you don't have infinite power, you have a limited power budget. Okay, so there are a couple of different types of antennas used to radiate radio frequency. You know, typically your Wi-Fi router, right? The Wi-Fi router would radiate radio frequency in all directions. This is a typical of antenna radiation pattern, right? But remember that we have a limited power budget. So why would you want to waste energy radiating radio frequency in all directions? So another idea is that, okay, why don't we try to shape this radio energy and push it towards a specific direction, right? So this is called beamforming, it's used in modern Wi-Fi routers actually. You could also use it for power delivery, but you realize that you're actually using radio energy to shape the radiation pattern of radio energy, which is, you're still kind of like wasting the power budget for that. I added the links at the bottom, so you know, if you guys like visit the slides after the talk, you can go and take a look at what I was reading. So my approach, I primarily use a directional antenna. Okay, I wanted to put the entire power budget in a very narrow beam to point it towards the target device that intends to receive the power, right? So a key benefit of this is that I don't have radio energy, you know, radiating all around. It's very directional. I did some preliminary tests walking around with a meter to see that it actually radiates the appropriate pattern. You can just get these antennas. I got mine, I think from eBay for about like $30. So they have a very narrow beamwidth. So you can imagine all this power, right, in that specific, radiating in a specific direction. Of course, it looks large, and some people in the community, they've made their own antennas. So you could make it lighter and cheaper if you do it yourself. So the general approach, okay, is that we want to scan the room for devices to be charged. And if we find devices to be charged, we charge them, right? Typically, you know, if it's less than 60%, we'll try to charge it. And when it reaches like more than 80%, we stop charging. So yes, these devices still have a battery. Well, they need a battery to store charge. But the good thing is that I just hope that we no longer need to replace them. Okay, and of course, there's an exception. If we can't charge the device faster than it's being drained, it should inform the user. Usually in these cases, you know, the battery is like 40 or spoiled, but you know, hopefully this will take a couple of years before it kicks in, right? So the typical beacon, it should just like radiate energy, it wakes up the device, and the device should feed back to me how much charge it has. And this happens during the scanning phase, which I'll demonstrate later. Okay, so the antenna is very directional, right? Which means that we have to move it around in order, in all angles, right, in order to cover a, suppose like assume like a 10 to 15 feet radius, and it should be able to point to various parts of the room. So in my prototype, I basically grab a couple of servo motors, Dynamixel. Anyone use Dynamixel servos here? In your robotics projects or, no? Okay. And there's another servo called Super 200, which I got from AliExpress. It is really crusty, Chinesium stuff. So if you want to read about my difficulties of getting it to actually do its work, you can click on the link below in future. So my demo is over there. I didn't want to put it here because it's too far from everyone. If there's a power socket there, we could plug it in and I can show you how it lights up an LED wirelessly, you know. But in general, this just spins around. Oops. Right, well, the model is that I will actually spin, move the antenna around. It would do like a 360 degree scan around the room for wireless devices and also change the phase because the antenna has a polarization, right? So you change the phase of the antenna as it goes around. So this is just a quick packed up wooden prototype just to allow me to like collect some data. Okay, and the receiver, I took quite a while to get this, but basically we have to have an antenna. It's a very naive design. I'm quite sure like if there's any RF experts or engineers here, you can probably do a better job. But it's a simple dipole, you know, did some impedance matching, hooked it up to a receiver. The receiver basically rectifies the RF energy, right, to get the DC voltage out of it, and we feed the DC voltage into the charge controller. Yeah, I have a list of materials in the next slide. Yeah, but the key idea here is that it's very important to get your antenna matching right, or else you would not have a good power efficiency. And of course, this naive design, it can be improved. The last measurement I took at about 10 to 15 feet is about less than 10 milliwatts of received power. Now, it may seem really little, but in the grand scheme of things, when you're talking about recharging low power sensors, IoT devices around the home, 10 milliwatts can go a long way. And think about it, you have like 24 hours a day for it to run, right? It's not like, you know, you have a short amount of time, but you have the whole day for this to slowly charge up your devices. So, quick run of key components. Transmitter, right? I just selected a transmitter with the highest possible power within safe limits. Well, I wouldn't want to, you know, like be exposed to too much radiation, like a microwave oven. So a directional antenna, we try to look for an antenna with the most narrow beam width you can find. Currently, I think it's something around 23 dBi. If I try to go higher, a smaller beam width means the antenna needs to be larger, which I don't want something that's too large. Yeah, the receiver antenna, probably have to run through some like simulations in like HFSS or those kinds of like RF simulation software to get a good, a good design. The RF DC component is pretty important because you can't simply drop in any random diode you find, right? It has to be something you know, that has like, how would I say, very little power loss, Schottky. So I shortlisted two models, right? One is the 1SS106 Hitachi. I didn't actually test this, I just googled it online. Someone used that to light an LED, that's great. I use the RFD102A. It's actually like an early prototype from some other microwave engineer in the States. Yeah. Charge controller is a pretty mainstream BQ25504, very low loss, works up to like 0.1 or 0.2 volts. So that's great. You can charge up a battery like a lithium cell or a 1.2 volt nickel metal hydride. So, yeah, and of course, your storage. Preferably, we choose a small cell because small cell results in faster voltage rise over time when you charge it up. So, results in better useful voltage for your system. So, some of the problems when occurred when I was testing, so I didn't actually test this myself, I asked someone to help me. Right, is that, you know, the cheap transmitter, which I got from China, right, has pretty bad, how would I say, it transmits a pretty wide band. You see, so naturally my antenna is narrow band and it only captures like part of power. Many of these other power transmissions and other frequency is lost. Yeah, so you know, if you design your own transmitter, definitely you can improve on this part. You could like have the entire 1 or 2 watts in the band that you want. So some of you may think like, okay, is it hard to visualize, you know, when you move the antenna around, you scan around the room, okay? Is it hard to know where the device is in real space? Now, my point is that it is not hard because I've actually done this before in a previous project, I think my final year project in NUS, where I like, kind of like tilted the antenna and scanned the physical space. And you know, we just plot a graph and we can easily see that there are clearly points where a certain orientation results in better signal strength than other positions. Yeah, this is actually data from another experiment, but it's a similar idea. Right. Sometimes you know, you may encounter, because like indoors, right, you may have like reflections along the walls or a metal cabinet or other things, right? So you may find that two positions or two orientations of your transmitter will result in a good signal being received at the receiver. Yeah, so and with this current prototype, you know, in future I probably will have time. But I'm actually a software engineer by day, and by night I'm like hacking all kinds of stuff, tearing down China parts. But yeah, when I have time, I probably collect more data, work on the battery transmitter communication, improve the antenna design. That actually needs more work because currently it's very polarized. Yeah, so I think that's all for now. Where I got a yeah. And just in case anyone is interested in related works, I used to do some research in antenna optimization, physically moving an omnidirectional antenna around, but those were undergrad days. Yeah. Anyone has any questions, Q&A? Yes?
You're already using beamforming to narrow the beam. Why not use that to scale the beam?
No, I'm not actually using digital beamforming. Primarily because I don't. Well, firstly, it's actually hard, right? I need to have like many amplifiers to you know change the phase of the beam, phase of every antenna, multiple antennas, and as demonstrated earlier, you know there's a lot of energy loss in beam forming. I need to use a lot of RF energy to form the beam in the first place.
So you're already using beam forming?
No, I'm not. I'm mechanically steering the antenna around.
The antennas are playing with 6 with 9 patch
antennas on it? Yes, but they are, how would I say, it's an antenna that has a narrow beam width. Because of those 9 antennas, the beam width is narrow and it's already designed that way. Yeah.
Can you set up first?
Okay.